of the way, Lord, in this word that you want to share. It is your word that's being shared. It is your life that's being shared. So I pray, Lord, that as we speak through what you have done in the past, that we can draw from them all these past experiences that you have preserved for us, Father, Lord, for this purpose. So we pray indeed that you prepare our heart to receive your words. So we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, as mentioned just now, that in the past few weeks, we have been going through the books of Ezra, as well as the book of Nehemiah, right? And in fact, both the book Ezra and Nehemiah are connected because they talk about the same story, same people at the same time. In fact, a lot of numbers, figures that you can find in Ezra, you can also find it in Nehemiah. Actually, to get a more complete picture, you need to read three books together, not two books. That's together with the book of Esther. So Esther, Nehemiah, and Ezra are the three books that center around the same time. They're giving you then a complete story. And from Nehemiah chapter 1 to 6, which Kaisen has shared, was talking about the rebuilding of the city wall of Jerusalem. Now, Ezra deal with the rebuilding of the temple. Nehemiah deal with the rebuilding of the city gate of Jerusalem. So they are different things at the same time. They're different. And chapter 1 to 6, talking about the how Nehemiah was stirred in his heart to come back to rebuild the wall. And up to chapter 6, it is now the wall completed, finished building, right? And chapter 7 onwards is talking about what happened after the rebuilding was completed. So before we go any further, I think that it's worthwhile for us to revisit again what happened that the wall need to be rebuilt. What happened in the past that leading to this event, right? Because that will give us that perspective about all things that happened that leading to this. So you can see here, this is a chart of the Old Testament timeline. I hope the words is not too small. I will not start, of course, from Genesis, it will be too long, but I will start from Exodus. You know, Exodus is when God delivered the Israelites from the land of Egypt into the promised land, right? So Moses was given the task to do so. And you can see that during this time, a lot of things happened. They were not able to go to the promised land immediately. They have to wander around the wilderness for 40 years. But during this time, God revealed to them, to Israel, who they are, who God is, right? The law was given, and the nature of God was given to them. All the laws and the festival that's supposed to set the Jew, the Israelite apart from the rest of the inhabitants around the area, to set them apart as a people for himself, is all given in a time of Exodus, right? You can see a lot of things that happened there, the parting of the Red Sea and so on. So, and they are to be delivered into a promised land, which is filled with flow with milk and honey, right? But they are not given this land on the silver platter. They're supposed to go and take possession of it. They're supposed to conquer it. It is not something that is a piece of land empty, just go and inhabit it. It's not like that. But there are people there. They're supposed to drive out all these Canaanites. In fact, there are seven tribes of people that were there that are supposed to drive them out. So Moses was not able to go into the promised land, but Joshua is the one who brought them crossing the river Jordan into the promised land. Right? And they were successful. God deliver them from the hand of all the enemies at that time. So the conquest was successful for the Israelites when they moved into the promised land. So, and in this time, of course, there are many things that happen. We will not go into that. After Joshua died, what happened was that the Jews, I mean the Israelites, we didn't call them Jews at the time, the Israelites start to forget about God, right? They have gone into idolatry. They've gone into sin. And the new generation has forgotten what God Yahweh has done for them. So then, because of that, God's anger was raised, and the Jews, the Israelites start to lose. They were being plundered, they were being conquered by other tribes that was around them, the neighbors. So when God didn't deliver them from these enemies, they cried out to God. And God, in response to that, what do? He raised up judges, leaders who will bring Israel to overcome those enemies. Those is the time of judges. Okay? So this period of judges spent over 400 years. You can see down there, these are the books in the Bible that correspond to the time. So if you are, you can take this one as your Bible study guide as well, that this is what happened that tell the story. So the time of judges, I'm sure you heard of names like Samson, right? It's one of the famous judges as well. So this time of judges is the time when a cycle going on. Israel sin, they lose, they cry out, raise judges, and then got delivered from the enemies. Then the cycle start over again. Many times. I think there are about 12 or 13 judges, if I can remember correctly. So this cycle go on and on for 400 years. Okay, while they are still in the land. What happened then is that over time, they say that, this is so tiring, right? All the nations around Israel has got kings, but Israel don't have kings. Israel only have judges, and this is just random people that got raised up over time, and they want to have a permanent king. So the Israelites start to talk to Prophet Samuel at that time. He said, please go talk to God. I want to have a king for our nation, right? So God was obviously not pleased with that, because God says that I want to be your king, but now you want a human king to rule over Israel. And therefore, anyway, this is what you want. God give it to them. After a lengthy search, they got King Saul. Right, that is the start of the period of kings. King Saul got in the picture, and you know the story. After King Saul, successor was King David. After King David was King Solomon, right? So that's the sad part, because that complete Israel as a nation only lasts three kings. From Solomon onwards, it's split into two because of the sin that Solomon had done. God says that I will tear your nation apart. So they're split into two nations. One is the northern kingdom, another is the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom is called Israel. The southern kingdom is called Judah, right? So the first king of the southern kingdom, Judah, is Rehoboam, which is the son of Solomon. And the king for the northern kingdom is Jeroboam, right? Who's actually one of the engineers, a builder that was under King Solomon before, right? So that's what happened. And it is during this time that Israel has gone way wayward. Idolatry set in. And you can see that from the books listed down there. The activity from God is so active. He sent prophets after prophets to warn Israel and Judah of the unfaithfulness of the idolatry that setting in. that says that God says that if you continue to do this, I'm going to deliver you to the hand of an enemies. Okay, and there over this period of time, there's so many that bad kings, they are good king. Good king, then things are better. Bad king, everything go downhill. So it's a cycle again of good king, bad king. But all the while, God is faithful. He sent messengers, he sent prophets to warn these nations of all the things that he will do for them. So true enough, what happened was that there's debate so far away from what was given to Moses way back in Mount Sinai, the law, right? That when Jeroboam start to have this this nation, he even create his own duplicate religion, okay, a counterfeit, because he doesn't have the Ark of Covenant, the temple, right? So he set up different worship places in at Samaria and Dan, for example. So this time, what God has done is really that he won them over and over again. And what happened was that the northern kingdom falls to the Assyrian. So God raised up the Assyrian and captured the northern kingdom and deported all these people to where? To Mesopotamia, northern side. Okay, they are all dispersed. All the 10 tribes were dispersed out. And so obviously then at that time the Assyrians are very, very wicked. They're very cruel and very wicked, and you can see that they're torturing the people of the Israelites. And they deported them, the nation was overwhelmed. You would think that Assyrian already reached Samaria. Assyrian already reached Lachish, in fact, just neighborhood city from Jerusalem. And they camp overnight. What happens? God stopped them. Overnight, an angel of God came and slaughtered 185,000 soldiers of the Assyrian army. At that time, they have no choice. The Assyrians have no choice. In fact, it was Sargon, the Assyrian king. They have no choice but to turn back because he cannot fight anymore. You know, when God prophesied earlier that Judah will not fall into the hand of Assyria, this is what happened, right? But Judah will still fall. But it will not fall in the hand of the Assyrians. So God stopped them, and it's continued on. Judah continued to exist for another 136 years. When the Babylonian now overcame the Assyrian and become a superpower, and the Babylonian came, and as prophesied by Prophet Jeremiah, that they come and conquer Judah. Okay, so the king at that time was Nebuchadnezzar. That's the king of Babylon. He plundered Jerusalem and his temple, and took their last king, King Jeconiah, and his court. Initially, Nebuchadnezzar only targeted the rich people, the noble. Okay, he took the king, the people of the court, the prominent citizen. All these people, they deported back to Babylon. Like they left those normal people around back in Jerusalem, in Judah. Okay, and in return, what happened is that Nebuchadnezzar appoint a puppet king. His name is called Jehoiakim. His name is called Zedekiah. So he is a puppet king of which Nebuchadnezzar appointed, right? And what happened was that Zedekiah, all of a sudden, he felt that, oh, I need to fight Nebuchadnezzar. Even though he's appointed by Nebuchadnezzar as a puppet king, he said, I need to fight them. And Isaiah says that, no, you don't fight him, right? So despite Isaiah giving a lot of warning to Zedekiah and says that instead you should repent, he did not listen. So what happened was that Nebuchadnezzar came back. He says that now you're challenging me, is destroy the whole city of Jerusalem. Okay, that's where the temple will destroy, the gate will destroy. Right? And that is because of that challenge. So, and worse still is that they deport everybody now to Babylon. That's why they are in exile. Okay, that's how the exile came about. During this time, they are living in Babylon. Now, the Jews are very good because in any situation, they can thrive and prosper. So when they are in Babylon, they're actually getting rich. Although they are exiled, they are rich. They are prosperous. Okay? And during this time, when they are in Babylon, what happened was that then the Persian king, God raised up the Persian, and the Persian won over the Babylon. Won over the Babylon. So after the fall of Babylon, the Persian king, King Cyrus the Great, in 538 BC, the exiled Jew began to return to the land of Judah. That's where you read from the book of Ezra, right? When a decree of Cyrus to say that, you know, these Jewish people can go back. Now, this is where the first time you see the word Jews. Jews is actually people of Judah. That's called Jews. So before that, we call them Israelites. But now we call them Jews because they are the people of Judah, right? And you know the story from there, that we came back and they rebuilt the city. And after that, they also rebuilt the wall of Jerusalem. That's where we come up to Nehemiah chapter 8. Okay. Now, there's also some background to this, that when the Northern Kingdom was deported, when they were exiled, what happened was that the Assyrian has a way of suppressing power. So what they do is that when they deport the Israelites out of the Israel, they took people from other regions that they captured and plant them into the land of Israel. Okay, so there are Gentiles who live in that area. That's why over time these people become the Jews, so-called. But they are not Jews, they are called Samaritans. And also you can see that during Jesus' time, you can read about the enmity becomes between the Jews and the Samaritan, right? Because they don't regard them as real Jews. They regard them as Gentiles, even though they live next door to each other in the same land. Okay, so this is the kind of history that we can have a setting as to why, what leads to the time of Jesus, all this background. Okay, so the Jews came back and they start to rebuild the city. And you can see from here also how close Nehemiah to the last prophet Malachi. It's only about 50-60 years. After the rebuilding of the city wall and the temple, is that almost the last call already. Malachi come out later on, and then there'll be 400 years of silence. That's how close we are to the return of to the birth of Christ at that time. Okay? And we're not going to go that direction, but sufficient to see that this is to give us some sense, to give us some perspective as to what kind of timeline we're talking about, right? Okay, so having that stage set, what you can see is that God has been working in the life of this Israel, this nation of Israel, for a long time, thousands of years. Right, and they come to this point when they are rebuilding a new life, they're rebuilding a new community. So going into the proper chapter, right, I'm supposed to share about Nehemiah chapter 7 and 8. There's not much in chapter 7 because there's just a list of names of those who return back, and that they declare that the completion of the city wall. So chapter 8 is a short chapter, in a way. So I'm not going to go through everything, but I'll pick up keywords from these few verses, and we see how does it apply that we can learn from there. All right. So from here, you can see that the first three verses, people gather as one man. Bring out the book of law of Moses. Both the men and women of who could understand what they heard, right? From early morning until midday, they gather. So from there, you can see that God's words give life to people whose heart is stirred. Now, look at it in this manner. The war is completed. The temple is completed. What is God after that? Is it just a structure, a place? The people are coming back. Everybody should be rejoicing. You know, now I have a place to worship. Now I feel safe. But you know that God is always after more things. After all the hardware they have, that spirit of worship, that renewal of that spirit that he wants to give to these people. Right? This is where this chapter come about. That when these people, the Jews, I think there are a number of 34,000, gather as one man. What is the meaning of gather as one man? It means that they are unity in spirit. Right? So, and these are very consistent with the rest of the Bible. Right? God's word gives life to people whose hearts are stirred. Now, Ezra, in the book Ezra, chapter 1, verse 5, it says that who are the people who return back from Babylon to from Persia to Israel are the people whom God stirred the heart. So not everybody come back. Only those whose heart was stirred, you can refer it to Ezra chapter 1, verse 5, are the one who returned back. Okay? So there is a kind of, you can call it selected people in a way, those who responded to the word of God, those who responded to the stirring of God. Those are the people who came back because, like I said, they have very good life there. So who would want that, live that good life and come back to a land that's nothing, right? And take a treacherous and dangerous journey as well to go back to Israel. It's like, I have no affinity to go back to China. My grandfather come from China. My father was born in Malaysia. So I'm second generation Chinese born in Malaysia. Do I have affinity to go back to China? No. Right. So it's not easy for people to leave that comfort to move back into Jerusalem. Okay? After 70 years in exile. And a lot of these people who came back, they never knew Israel. They never know the land. They were not born there. They were born in Babylon. So God stirred that heart of these people to come back. And they responded. And therefore they come back. And these people, you can see that having the same spirit that united as one, gathered as one man, they can come back and gather as one man. That's the union in spirit. So in Psalm 133, I just read very short Psalm because it's only three verses. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is the precious oil upon the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the edge of his garment. It's like the dew of Hermon, descending upon the mountain of Zion, for the Lord commanding the blessing, life forevermore. So you can see that when people are coming together in one, unity in spirit, anointing will come. That's what the psalmist say in Psalm 13. Right? Anointing will come. How then these people will even gather for 6 hours, right? From early morning until midday. They gather there for 6 hours just to receive their words. And they're hearing the words, God of word for the first time, right? So, and then from the verse 4 to verse 6, what happened is that they're very attentive. They hear carefully what is being preached, what's being said, what's being shared. Okay, although Ezra was in the platform, like me, like this, but people are gathered together and they're attentive. And how do they respond? When they're treating the word of God in a reverent manner, holy manner. Because why? Is it? People responded, amen, amen, lifting their hand and bow their head, worship the Lord with their faces to the ground. So if you look through the Bible, you can see that every time people worship God with their faces to the ground, what happened? The presence of God is there. Okay? So when you see that, it's always there's a presence of God. People are so overwhelmed that their face have to face down to the ground. Okay? You can see that in throughout Old Testament, New Testament. So spiritual renewal, hearing the word of God attentively, treating the God, word of God reverently, and responding to the presence of God. Okay, so these few verses up to verse 6 talking about this, right? Then continue on for verse 7 to 8. There are names of people here. Help the people to understand the law. Clearly, the words are of the law, the words of God were spoken clearly to give them a sense so that people understand the reading. So you can see that for this spiritual renewal, the word of God must be taught and the teaching must be accurate and clear and give them meaning that they can relate to, right? So it's just not about reading it, but there is an understanding. So people need to understand what they're reading. People need to understand what they have been preached to. Okay? So that there's a requirement for commitment from both the teacher as well as the people who were taught. Right? So you must be ready to receive the word. Likewise, the person who preach must be also knowledgeable in the word of the law. Okay? So, and in verse 9 to 12, all the people wept when they heard the word of God. The weep. And weeping, why do people weep? Because now they see this is the word of God. They realize how poorly they have been living. Okay? They have been down, they realize that how far away they are from God, how they have not been keeping the statute of the Lord. So you can see in Nehemiah chapter 9, actually, talking about why they weep, but I'm not going there. But just to give you the perspective, is that they even cry out because their forefathers did not follow the way of God, right? So the repentance is not just about themselves. It's also about their forefathers. It's also about the nations, right? So the word of God is so deep, the conviction is so deep that they'll go into that area as well. So you can see there's a repentance, there's a joy, there's fellowship, because you eat and you drink is fellowship. Right, and good deeds, you do good deeds because you even give your portion to those who did not prepare. Right, so these are the response you can see. Now, so people don't come together because they don't fellowship because you know they come together. They fellowship because God has done the work in their life. The word has done his work in their life. Therefore, they have, as a result, there's a fellowship. Okay. And we didn't read this part earlier in the scripture reading, but continue on, you can see that from verse 13 to the verse 18, talking about the next day. The next day, the leaders of the fathers came back again to gather around Ezra to further understand the word of law. So they don't just have one meeting and that's it. They come back again and they say, I want to know more. I want to know more. Okay? So they hunger for the words and they found. By the way, I have missed this part, which is also important, is that way back in the first few verses, there are certain information here that we just just pass by very quickly. First of all, they gather on the first day of the seventh month at the place facing the water gate, right? Now, this is a perspective. The first day of the seventh month is actually the starting of the Feast of Trumpets. Feast of Trumpets is actually meant for purification. It's a seven-day feast, but the Jews forgotten about it. So they're actually not aware that they're supposed to celebrate the Feast of Trumpets on that day. So they didn't know. So later on, as we read just now, that when they came back, they found that there's more to the words, that there is a requirement for them to do something, right? So the The first day of June, of the seventh month, is the Feast of the Trumpet, last for 7 days. And they are facing Watergate. There are actually 10 gates in the city gate of Jerusalem, 10 gates. One of it is a Watergate. Watergate signifies purification. That's where you wash your sins away, right? So the place, the time, the people that gather at that time is all has meaning. All has a way of God saying that you need to purify yourself, right? In this assembly, it's where the spiritual renewal will come. So you can see from here as well that on the second day, when they go back and restudy again the word even more deeply, they found that, hey, this month is also the month where we celebrate Sukkot, the Feast of Tabernacle, right? And they're supposed to build tents and live there for 7 days, which I shared, I think, the last time about the Sukkot. So, and they immediately said, let's do that. So that meaning that the reading of the Word of God, when they understood, they will lead to what? Lead to obedience. Right? If you have a people that understand the Word, it will lead to obedience and lead to worship because they kept the feast for 7 days. They will have joy. They have gladness, great gladness. So from there, you can pick from all these things that happened on just on that event itself, a lot of keywords that come about, right? We will not have time to go through each and every one, but you can safely say that every single principle that we pick up from there has a biblical base. You can go by the Bible and say that this is biblical, right? We have this kind of response. So what can we gather from this event? How does it apply to us? I mean, when we talk about to Christians, right, do you want spiritual renewal? Everybody says, I want spiritual renewal. Who doesn't want it, right? And in many times even says that we are in church for so long that we didn't even advance in our spiritual life. We are degrading in a way. We keep stopping where we were, right? And there's no growth. There's no growing in our desire. No growing. Why? So this is, if I apply this, what we see on Nehemiah 8, into a model. I wouldn't say it's model. I'm just putting a question mark, right? For us to think about spiritual renewal. What is the condition? The condition will be that as a unity in spirit, right? When people have the same spirit in all, there's a knowledgeable person who are knowledgeable in the Word of God, who can dispense as expound it. And those who listen to the Word can understand them. Okay? So this is a setting when you have spiritual growth, when the people will hunger for the words. That's the condition. And what's the action to that? Reading the Word of God. Not my opinion, not my presentation, but reading the Word of God and expound on it. And we're not constrained by time. I mean, these people were meeting for 6 hours. You know, can you imagine that the speaker come, I have a word for you today. Oh, sorry, my time is up. I cannot proceed any further. So, you know, there's no constraint by time. There's no tyranny of time. Hearing God's words in reverence, because the Word of God is God himself. So how do we treat the Word of God? Must be in reverence and holiness. Okay? Then we know that it will do something to us. Teaching the words to be understood, right? And what's the outcome? Outcome is that there will be conviction of sin. There will be fellowship. There will be repentance, leading to obedience and joy in the Lord. So perhaps this is a model that we can see, but we know that consistently, these are the words that you hear throughout the Bible. So, next, I want to follow up on one particular verse in the whole chapter of Nehemiah 8. That is Nehemiah 8, verse 10, right? Which is the title of today. There's a joy of the Lord is my strength. Okay? So, this is the background that we lay down. But in particularly, I'm very intrigued and attracted by this verse. For the joy of the Lord is my strength. Okay, so let's read again from verse 9 to verse 12. and to see what we can uncover from these few verses. It's actually quite repetitive, but I hope that you will speak to us in a way that we can understand. This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep, for all the people wept as they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, go your way, eat the fat, and drink sweet wine, and send portions to anyone who has nothing ready. For this day is holy to our Lord, and do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. So the Levite come, all the people, saying, be quiet, for this day is holy, do not be grieved. And the people went their way to eat and drink and to send portions and to make great rejoicing, because they had understood the words that were declared to them. So what is that key? What is that key that turning from weeping to joy is that they understood the word that was declared to them? Okay? Now, you know that when you hear the word, people wept because they hear the word. There were grief, right? There were mourning, there were grief. So likewise, in our modern setting, when we are depressed, when we are not happy, what do? You eat, right? When you're not happy, depressed, you eat, correct? And you drink, and you do good things. You hope that, you know, all these things will help you to overcome your grief. All these things will help you to you know, you have a few good factors of it now because you fill up yourself with all these things. So non-Christian can tell you all this technique, right? You're not happy, you grieve, do this. Self-help books, right? And eventually it boils down to making yourself feel good. And it's biblical. You can see that here. That it's biblical that you eat and drink. But the thing is that you don't overcome your grief by eating. That's not the purpose. You overcome that grief because you understood the word. And of which, once you've understood the word, leading you to do the next thing, which, you know, eating and go on with your life and do good deeds, right? So it's not the other way around. If you must have that understanding of the word first. Only then, so if for a non-Christian, for a secular people, this is a good thing. So I'll just skip that part of understanding the word because they have no desire to understand the word. So you just do the technique. So take a technique to overcome your grief. Overcome whatever things, right? So what happened? When that feel-good factor is gone, you go back to your depressed state. Whereas you can see that for Christians and those who are really being worked by the word of God, their joy can be sustained. The joy, you know, as recently as we hear some testimony of those missionaries to Myanmar, to Burma, okay, the kind of hardship that they go through and the grief that they have to go through because their children die and all these things, right? The hardship that they go through. But the joy that they have is just tremendous. Where does it come from? It comes from because they understood the word of God in their life, right? So, if I may go to go a bit deeper, okay? For this verse, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. I think before that, let me go to here. James 4, verse 7 to 10. James 4, verse 7 to 10 is that, submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinner, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy into gloom. Humble yourself before the Lord. He will exalt you. So it is perfectly normal, perfectly natural, and even expected that when you are convicted of your sin, when you see how sinful you are, that you're turned into a mourning, you're turned into grieving. Okay? So that is that's a good thing. But for us, we feel that, hey, you must stop grieving, you know, without having the understanding the working of God. But it says here, God will exalt you. It means that God will bring you the joy later when you're exalted, after you've been through this season. But you must understand the working of God. So the question now we want to go into is that, for this verse, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. What does it really mean? So, the joy of the Lord, you can see it both, you can read it in both ways. Is it the joy that the Lord gives, or the joy that the Lord has? Right? So, I believe that it is a joy that the Lord gives, because why? The people feel joyful after that. Right? So, it is something that God gives to the people. And the word strength here is in the Hebrew word, it's called, I don't know how to read this, ma'os, maybe. It's also meant stronghold, refuge, fortress, protection. In fact, this word ma'os appeared 37 times in the Old Testament. And out of which, 14 times translated as stronghold, 7 times as refuge, 7 times as fortress, right, and so on and so forth. Only in this instance, in this verse, for the joy of the Lord is your strength, is translated as strength. That's the only time that is considered as strength. So if I go with that, it's more like the joy of the Lord is your fortress, is your refuge. That will be a proper way to read into this passage. Okay? Why? This is how it looks like. So you have the sin, judgment, guilt, condemnation that will give you grief, right? It's very biblical, as James said, that when you are convicted of these sins, when the people of the Israelite, they hear the word of God, they will grieve because of the sin of their father, sin of themselves. They see now how far are they living away from God. They grieve. So how do you turn that grief into joy? Now, the problem with many of us is that we stay in that grief mood for a long time. Yeah, God, I was wrong. I was convicted of all these things. I'm not worthy of these things. So your grief is correct. But the problem is that we stay in that grief forever. We do not know how to come up from there to go into the presence of God. Right? So that's only the first step of having that conviction of sin. But where do you go from there? Where do you go to? Just like what Silas song just now. Where do you go? Where else can you go? You got to go to God. So the word of God is that conviction that like a door, right? That will allow you to go from grief to the joy. That's the word of God. So inside this side of the door, you would have forgiveness, you have hope, you have joy, you have peace. That feelings, that knowledge of forgiveness and hope and peace will give you joy, right? And that stronghold is the word of God that keep you, as long as you abide inside this stronghold, you will experience joy, right? The moment that you leave from this place, you go to sin, judgment, and condemnation again, right? So this is a kind of picture when it says that the joy of the Lord is my refuge. Joy of the Lord is my strength. This is a picture that is, you know, I get this picture from there. So don't stay in that grief. You all should be grief. Yes, correct. But don't stay there. Go to the Word. Go to God. Because it's only have that understanding of God working that your grief can be turned into joy. So what is the conclusion? You can see that throughout the history of Israel as a nation, what God distinct from the nation Israel from the rest of the people is the word that was given to him, to them. The word of God, the law of God that was given to them, the way of life that God has prepared for them, given to them. That's what distinct the people Israel from the rest of the world. Okay? What happened? Throughout history, they forgot the word of God. they have over and over again fallen to idolatry, the sin, and they cry out. Again, God delivered them. So God has been dealing with Israel. And even when prophet Amos was giving the prophecy to them, he said the reason why God is going to punish you is because he wants to turn your attention back to him. He wants to turn you back to him. That's the purpose of that prophecy. That's the purpose of that judgment. Okay, if you read the book of Amos consistently throughout, right? That is a message that affliction that God will give to you is so that you turn to him, not turn you away from God. But we take it that, oh, the affliction is for me, turn away from God, because why me? Why I have to suffer this? But actually, it's the other way around. The affliction that God has given them is to turn the Israelites back to God, right? So what is consistent here is that throughout history, despite the Israelite having the words forgotten God, having, you know, gone into worshipping other gods and things like that, the word of God remained unchanged. It was relevant from day one when the word was given to Moses. It was relevant to them when the time of Ezra and Nehemiah reading back the words to them. They still have that kind of conviction. Today, it's the same, right? You still have that conviction. The word of God remains unchanged. So Jesus is the Logos, is the word of word of God become flesh. So he says that God, we want to know you. How do you know God if you don't know his words? Because the word of God is Logos, right? So when he says that I want to have a God give me a piece of you to me, you know, what does that mean? If you don't read, every time you read the word of God, that means that whatever that you receive is God imparting himself to you, depositing himself to you. So if you don't read, you will never know who God is, right? And the last time I shared was that salvation is know who God is. Internal life is knowing who God is. It's not bringing to a place, but it is that word of God that remain unchanged. To know God is to know his word. And secondly, that we can see from here, throughout, learn from the history of Israel, is that God is faithful. How many times the Israelite has rejected God? How many times have they turned into idolatry? How many times have they, you know, forgotten about God? But God is remained faithful, right? Despite all the rejection, they say, I don't want you, God, I want my own king. I don't want you, God, I want my own God. So, but God has remained faithful in his covenant. Okay, he has promised us salvation and hope. So it will still be relevant, right? So turn your eyes to God, to Jesus. Whatever that is working in your heart, right? Whether it's grief, whether it's, you know, at the end of the day, you can see that throughout history, the working of God is that his word remains. His faithfulness is unquestionable. Okay, so that's what I have that I prepared. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you that your words indeed is unchanging. Your words remain true even to today. Your word has such a power that is in even in Corinthians. In first letter of Corinthians chapter 2, that that our faith not rests on the wisdom of man, but on the power of God. So we pray, Father Lord, indeed that we know, we learn of you, that we learn of your word. We know that you are faithful, that our faith is not a blind faith, but our faith is based on your faithfulness, because we know that you are faithful. Therefore, Lord, we also can be faithful. It is your words, Lord, that will cut us through. Your words that give us, bring us to repentance. So we pray, Father, for spiritual renewal in our life, in this church as well. So that, Lord, you'll be fill us, Lord, with your spirit. That we will be united in one as you. The church, you say that the church cannot be divided by itself. The church, the body cannot be divided. How can we, Lord, come to know you if we ourselves do not know one another? So we pray. Pray, Father, Lord, that you come to us in this manner. Lord, that you will convict us, turn our grief into joy, when your conviction comes, Father Lord, that let there be grief, but turn that grief into joy. So we thank you. Jesus' name we pray. Amen.